Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Resonance Arcade. It is Wednesday night and we are live. As you can see, I'm joined by Sam today, just Sam, and we're all big. Got big images, hello. So you can probably see our features a bit better than normal. So traditionally, we start off with talking about games, and that's what we're going to do. We haven't got much news or gaming news this week because we've all been a bit lazy, to be fair, and we can't find anything today that's even remotely interesting, apart from maybe one story we'll have a quick chat about. But so we'll talk about the games that we've been playing, and I'll let you kick off, Sam, because you haven't been on for a few weeks, have you?
Quite a few Wednesday nights, so working late enough that I can't get back in time to start this. So I'll start with one that we're already familiar with and we've talked about a lot, but I finally finished The Witcher 3's main story a few days ago.
Have you played the DLC?
I haven't played any of the DLC other than the free stuff that was already included. Hearts of Stone, is it?
Yeah, have you got it though? Have you bought it?
No, I haven't bought it, no.
I said I completed The Witcher 3 a while ago, and Steve last week said to me that he said, oh, have you played all the DLC, the Hearts of Stone stuff? And I said, no. He said, well, you haven't completed it then. I was like, well, that's not fair. You can't.
The main game,
yeah,
over 100 hours or whatever.
He was absolutely adamant that, nope, until you played all the DLC, you haven't completed it. But I'm not going to pay an extra 20 quid or whatever for something that I probably won't play at the moment, to be honest. I've had enough of me Witcher for now.
Yeah, there's another DLC coming out, Summer and Wine or some shit. That's the next one, and I'm sure they'll be good. I'm sure they'll have like their own little spin-off stories, and you go to a different island or something. Just that I wanted to crack on with the main story, just to finish it, because I'd sort of left it behind when I got into Metal Gear Solid 5, and then Fallout 4 came out, which I've also kind of abandoned after playing a lot of hours and then gone. I'll finish it later.
Yeah, I haven't started the main quest on Fallout 4.
I've done a bit of it.
120 hours of side quests, and that's it. I do want to go back to it. It's on my list, but I wanted to get a few of my other big games out the way.
Yeah, I wanted to finish The Witcher because I actually got invested in it though, because I got invested in the story. And then I got to the point basically just before you go to Kaer Morhen, which is apparently, according to the game's act structure, is the sort of end of Act 2 of the main story, where you do the Battle of Kaer Morhen. Spoilers, we're going to go into spoilers, by the way. That's what I'm talking about this
probably, for. Probably finger up spoiler for that.
Witcher 3 spoilers.
Witcher spoilers.
Yeah. For a while. I'll put my finger up again once I stop, so that'll probably be easier. But I really, really liked the story, and I'd stopped doing the side quests, and I'd done most of the secondary quests that you can find by getting notice boards and stuff anyway, so I'd already done most of that stuff that could be available. All I had left to do was a couple of treasure hunts, which I got bored of, and a load of random question marks around the Isles of Skellige, which are pretty much guaranteed to either be monster dens or treasure chests that I'm also not that bothered about.
Yep.
So I've done most of the stories and the extra stuff in the game anyway, really. There's only a few little bits that I wasn't bothered about in the first place that I just left unfinished. So I just ploughed on and spent a few hours just doing main story missions for a couple of days until I finished it, which is actually quite cool. It's quite nice to just play the main story and remain invested in that. So
I agree. I did the same thing. When I went back to it after a short break, I went back and I just did what you just said. I stopped doing the side quests, and I'm not even sure if I've completed all the side quests. I know I've done all of the armor side quests, but that's probably about it.
I've done all but one of the Witcher contracts that was available. I mean, I'm guessing if I wander around and meet random people, I might get given more, but I've done all the notice board ones that you can do and all the ones that you get. There are probably hidden ones though that I've not done, because there's a lot of question marks around Skellige that I've not been to.
Is it the question marks that? Yeah, I've done all of the. I've done the same, and I don't think I've done all the question marks myself. It doesn't matter anyway. It's a while since I played it.
Yeah, but it was really. I really liked it when you got Ciri with you and you finally found her. It was a really nice sort of moment in the game, and then you immediately then get to decide how you interact with Ciri and what kind of sort of fathery mentor kind of guy you're going to be, which I quite liked as well. And it's not like these are huge things, but it's little things like Well, do you sort of support her decisions, or do you try and say, no, Ciri, don't do this and don't do that? Mm. I was more in the camp of like, well, I'd seen Ciri's journey because you have those little cutaway scenes when you play as her anyway. So I was pretty much like, yeah, man, like, I already know that you're pretty awesome because I've played as you. So if you think this is the right thing to do, fuck it, let's go and do that. So I actually ended up getting the good ending as well, which was pretty cool. Where, well, it depends on how you look at it. My ending, Ciri became a Witcher in my ending.
Oh, God, I can't even remember what mine was now.
I've looked it up since. There are, like, three main endings. There's obviously a few little bits, like, it depends on if you get with Yennefer or Triss or nobody. That affects a little bit of Geralt's stuff.
But I got with nobody by the end. Triss disappeared. She was there at the end, but she went off in the middle of the game.
She comes back in Kaer Morhen, didn't she? Or she did for me, anyway.
She comes back for a little bit at the end of the game, but not much. It's only when... It's when you do the final mission.
Mm.
And I thought that was just scripted that she'd come back anyway.
It possibly was. There's probably a way you can piss her off, but she's still... You know, like, they can write it in a way that you can piss a character off, but they can still put that aside to help you, like, not let the world go to shit sort of situation. Which is, you go around and collect all your allies to come and help you at Kaer Morhen, and the Battle of Kaer Morhen was really cool. The last mission as well, with the where you fight Eredin, and it's all on the frozen sort of icebergs and stuff. That was a really cool final mission.
Yeah,
there is a mission slightly before that where you go and fight one of the guy who killed Vesemir. Again, spoilers. You kill the guy who killed Vesemir, and the Ciri says, "Oh, I want to face him." And Geralt, and you know, I'm as good a swordsman as you. And Geralt goes, "We both know that's not true." And I was like, "No, Geralt, she's a better swordsman than you." Playing as Ciri is like playing on easy mode compared to playing with Geralt, because she can like teleport and dash and fucking.
Yeah, that's not like, doesn't make her a better swordsman though, does it?
She's a better fighter, whatever. She's better at killing people than Geralt.
She's better at transporting herself between dimensions.
When you play as Ciri, you're nearly invincible.
Yeah, no, it is. It's more like there's no point in dying because this is just to tell a story, though. That's, I think, the way that the...
Yeah, I understood that. Yeah. Well, it's just one of those little moments where I was like, she's kind of better than you, Geralt, actually. But never mind. I really enjoyed the ending, and I really enjoyed... It's the kind of game where, like, this is the same with a lot of games like Skyrim and Grand Theft Auto and things like that. When you've got so many side quests to do, the main story feels like you're doing it in bits and pieces.
Hmm.
And when you get bored of doing side quests, you do a main quest. But it was quite cool to just spend a good solid like 8 or 9 hours just doing the last main quest of the game and finishing it in like a fairly concentrated couple of sessions.
Yeah.
And it was quite rewarding and satisfying. And it felt good at the end. It was like, oh, that was a good ending. I like that. I really enjoyed that story.
How far did you get with the Gwent sets?
I'm not entirely sure. I don't really know how you gauge. I definitely missed the Bloody Baron's unique card. There weren't any more options. It was still open as a quest, but there weren't any more options for me to win any unique cards off main characters.
Did you do the tournament?
The tournament in Novigrad.
I think it's Novigrad, yeah.
Yeah, I did do that. I did that fairly early on, actually. As soon as that was available, I did it, basically, and won, obviously. You know, you've got to win, get all the cards.
It's quite a difficult tournament, and you only get one chance as well all the way through.
I did definitely use a little bit of save.
Save scum.
I was a bit like, well, if I don't win, I'm definitely going to go back and use an earlier save to win.
Well, I suppose I was quite lucky because I wasn't at that point save scumming. I was very good at Gwent by that point. But I had a bug on the final guy. The final guy just froze in place and duplicated. I've actually got a screenshot that goes at the beginning of the show. He duplicated in like two, split into two versions of himself and just sat there. And it's like he's doing two different animations, but it was just a loop. So I had to reload anyway, but I probably would have lost that match. I was so close to it.
Yeah. I did do a couple of side quests. There was a side quest, the crazy king guy, who takes over Novigrad and starts burning witches and stuff. Radovid.
Yes.
There's a side quest where you can assassinate him, and I was like, hell yes, I want to do that quest. Well, you don't assassinate him personally, but you see to it that he dies. And I was well up for that, because I was like, he's a complete fucking wanker. And I know that witches weren't supposed to be involved in that kind of affair, but I was like, nah, he's killing my friends and the people that like have helped me out in the past, so he's got to go. Yeah. And he made Novigrad into a bit of a police state as well. And it wasn't like Novigrad towards the end of the game. as a place to go and wander around in was a lot more hostile than it was at the start of the game. So I was definitely up for getting him bumped off. But yeah, really, really loved the story of The Witcher 3, in particular the ending. I really, well, there's multiple endings, but I loved the way that it could end. Hmm. The ending that I got, I actually really enjoyed it. It was really satisfying. Basically, I had Ciri became a Witcher, and at the end of the game, you give her this like really mastercrafted silver sword, and he's like, it's just like, oh, it's beautiful. And then she takes it, and then it's like Ciri went off and was a Witcher.
That rings
bells. And then Geralt and Yennefer basically retired and spent their day like hunting food and shagging in hot tubs. Basically, that's what the end of the game said. I don't know if they're going to do a sequel. They could obviously say, and then Geralt came out of retirement and did this, but that's basically the ending that I got, which I was completely happy with. Apparently, there's another ending where Ciri can die at the end. She can sacrifice herself and not come back, and she can become the Empress and take over from the Emperor of Nilfgaard and become like a benevolent, powerful Empress. Okay, which you can also see as a positive ending as well, actually.
I got the Witcher ending then in that case, because I definitely didn't get the other two.
Yeah, and apparently that ending is about what how you sort of support and talk to Ciri once you've regrouped with her. Or apparently a couple of your old side quests kind of make a bit of a difference, but generally it's about how you are with her and how you talk to her and what if you make her feel confident about herself and things like that. And it's also about if you take her to see her father as well, has an effect on whether she becomes the Empress or a Witcher. Right. There's a few little. I had sort of looked up a few different sort of the sort of criteria you have to hit for the various endings, because there are multiple different end states. Because there is obviously there's the romantic stuff. There's the obviously if you kill Radovid or not, what side quests you do, blah 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 blah. This kind of stuff affected it. But yeah. Excellent game, excellent story. Glad that I finally finished it. I can sort of put it to bed properly and come back to it fresh in the future.
I've been finishing a lot of games recently on, you know, not kind of bowing out before the final cutscenes, if you know what I mean. And it's a better place to be, I think, in general.
I like the closure. That's why I like games that have an ending, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
So yeah, I've talked about The Witcher for a bit. Why don't you talk about one of yours that you've played?
Okay, so I suppose as soon as you went around last week and Stee and Chris, our guest last week, wasn't interested in the game in particular, I want to talk about Batman Arkham Knight a little bit, because cool. I know that you've played it and I know that you are a fan. And have you completed it?
Yeah, I did complete it, yeah.
Okay.
Well, I totally like was on that game and got a bit compulsive about having to beat it towards the end. I was like, I have to do this. So yeah, I went right into it.
So I stopped playing it about 10 hours into it and restarted it recently from right from the start. And I have 100%ed it, absolutely nailed every single thing. I've done all of the most wanted missions.
Yeah.
You know, killed the Riddler, got every single Riddler trophy, did every mission, and got the Nightfall ending as well.
Yeah.
Which I think are just different cutscenes at the end, but which...
Hang on, the Nightfall ending, what's that?
So the Nightfall ending is if you 100% it, you get the... spoilers for the end of Arkham Knight, for those who...
We're doing spoiler sessions.
Yeah, may very well not want to know. At the end of the game, if you 100% it and you get all the Riddler trophies, you kill all of the... I think you can. There's two different endings. There's a 70% ending and a 100% ending.
Oh, I did hear that, but I always, like, in the previous Arkham games, I always made sure that I'd done all the extra stuff before finishing it.
Same here. So I got 100%, and it was essentially Bruce, you know... Scarecrow reveals Bruce Wayne as Batman.
Of course, yeah, that's it. Yeah, you had that sort of that weird ending, don't you, where he like flies down as a massive. There's like a little epilogue thing where you see Batman fly down, but it's like it looks like a monster right at the very end, and it's like, oh, all right, what's that about then?
Oh, right, yeah, that's the full Nightfall ending. Yeah, that's the very last bit. But there's speculation about what the hell that was. Was that fear toxin? Was that a new Batman? Was that Bruce Wayne? Did Bruce Wayne actually die? Did he not die? Essentially, the ending that I got was he goes down into Bruce Manor and walks into Bruce Manor with his helmet off, and him and Alfred asks him, "Are you absolutely sure about this, sir?" And then the Bruce Manor blows up, or Wayne Manor, Bruce Manor.
Bruce Manor. For sake.
And so that's the ending. But
yeah, I said spoilers
over. But then after that, it goes down to the one that the ending that you said. But I thought the game was. I mean, I loved Arkham Asylum and I loved Arkham City. I haven't played Arkham Origins in anger, so I can't really judge it. But I thought the game was amazing all the way through. I mean, I thought the story was great. I thought the boss battles were, some of them were a little bit arbitrary, but most of them were quite well put together. I thought the challenges were interesting. I thought the whole dialogue, the whole fact that the Joker is with you,
yeah,
all
I love
the way
that.
Through the game is brilliant. I just really enjoyed it, and Steve couldn't understand why I'd enjoy it, and my answer to it is, you are Batman.
Does he not understand the appeal of these games in general, or did he play Arkham Asylum and not like it, or what's
I don't
the thing?
Think
he, it's like
he'd have to answer himself. I don't know, but I think it's the first one. I don't think he understands the appeal of them.
I mean, it's not just the fact that you are, even if you say, right, if you're not a fan of, say, Batman and all this crap, just take it as the fact that it's a really, really well-made sort of Metroidvania-style action puzzle-y platformer where you get some really awesomely cool gadgets which you upgrade and have to use in interesting ways. It has an extremely addictive combat system. And it has a really well-written story with superb voice acting and production values. Like, even if you take all the Batman away, you've still got a great game. It just is really good. The thing that I didn't like about this game, and I say I didn't like it, I got a bit tired of it towards the end, was that all the tank battles that you have to do, there's a lot of that. I got a little bit like, cured of this. I was like, I want to be... And I love the Batmobile, but I was a bit tired of always having to be in combat mode in it all the time.
I think I understand where you're coming from, but I didn't really get tired of it. I thought I didn't really get tired of any of the quests. I enjoyed looking for the Riddler trophies. Nothing annoyed me like these kind of games normally do. It usually gets to a point where you're like, right, I just want to finish it now. Like, again, we go back to Assassin's Creed and the bloody feathers, you know, it's like who in the right mind is going to collect 200 odd feathers, but 250 odd Riddler trophies didn't seem to bother me in the slightest, you know? I was perfectly fine with it.
I think there's more than 250.
No, there's 250.
About 500.
No, there's about 250.
Is it? Right, yeah. Oh, I seem to think there's like astronomical amount. But then there's the bit of the trophies, but then there are the Riddler like puzzle rooms as well, aren't there, that you have to do that are separate things?
No, there's 250... I think there's 250 puzzles in all. Not including the mission one, you know, the ones where the most wanted ones. Which is about 15 or 20 of them, I think, in all. Is that many? Maybe not that many.
I don't know. There's a lot. There's a lot of them. Mm. I really liked the city design as well. I liked to sort of navigate. I liked the fact that there was three distinct areas to the city that felt interesting. Like, you get the high-rise area at the end, which is like... And these are big fucking skyscrapers at the end of this game as well. I was quite impressed by that. The fact that you can swoop down about, like, half a mile of skyscraper and then just, like, come up at the bottom and then go for a glide. That's the kind of gift that keeps on giving, really, in terms of gaming enjoyment for me. If I can continuously find the traversal of the environment entertaining in an open-world game, then they've essentially succeeded. And I did. I always enjoyed both driving round and then jumping out of the Batmobile at random moments and just having going for a crazy glide, and getting all your glide upgrades as well means you can do some crazy fast city traversal that makes the city feel small but still big at the same time.
Yeah.
Very well designed. Obviously, it had a load of PC issues, but like I said at the time, as a game, it was a great game. It was on the PlayStation 4. It was... You know, really cool. Really like the story as well. Even though I could see some of it coming, because I know a little bit of the crack with like Jason Todd and his whole thing, I still enjoyed it. I think they did a good version of that story, and they did it well, especially incorporating the other sort of Bat family characters into it as well, and how they would interact, like the way that they did Jim Gordon, even Tim Drake as Robin and Nightwing. I quite liked the fact that they got more screen time in this game. They were more important to the plot than they were.
Well, you know, I'm not a big like comic book fan, But I mean, I didn't know quite a lot of the lore behind Batman. I didn't know, for example, that Nightwing was Robin or Tim Drake.
Yeah, Dick Grayson is the first Robin, and he's like his own guy now, Nightwing. Yeah, because he grew up over time, basically.
Okay, so gonna more spoilers. So more Arkham Knight spoilers that you and I can talk about, but maybe not everybody wants to know. Well, in fact, you definitely don't want to know, even if you are a Batman fan, unless you've played the game, I think. So the Arkham Knight, you said when you originally played it that you were a bit disappointed with who the Arkham Knight was.
I think I called it very early. I think really? I enjoyed the story.
You
I could tell that. I could tell. I think that's the point. I think any Batman fan knows that spoilers that the Arkham Knight is Jason Todd, former Robin. Believed to have been killed by the Joker. And in comic book continuity, again, he was believed to be killed by the Joker and didn't come back until a good 20-odd years until after that whole storyline was done. So they did essentially revive that character from the dead. He had been dead for a long time. And it was one of those things that Batman had always had this, like, even more, you know, stuff to put on Batman's plate. And he's already pretty fucked up, but he's got the death of Jason Todd that he always felt personally responsible for. And so they've done that story and done some interesting stuff with Jason Todd coming back and all this kind of shit. So I mean, did I say I was disappointed? But they were disappointed that they did exactly what I thought they were going to do, but at the same time they did handle it quite a way, and it still had to sort of emotional impact.
I wasn't disappointed. I was actually, that's a good twist, because as someone who doesn't know the plot or didn't know that that was coming or didn't know that that happened at some point, that Robin had been killed by the Joker, I was not aware. It was really cool to see some of the, you know, the scenes, the fear toxin scenes, just
yes,
to say,
yeah.
Sorry, we're starting to repeat now. Just to some of the fear toxin scenes, just to see the Joker kill Robin, and then after that, realize that guy is Robin. As someone who doesn't know that, I thought it was a really good twist. I thought it was cool, and that's why I enjoyed the story, I think, because I thought even though the Arkham Knight himself wasn't that dynamic and interesting a character, I liked the concept behind it. I thought the boss fight with the Arkham Knight was pretty good, though.
Yeah, it was quite interesting. I'm quite glad that they did that, because it was the whole point of him. His whole thing was, I know all your tricks, da 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 da. And you had to sort of, it was similar to the Mr. Freeze fight in Arkham City, where it was like you had to be inventive and make the most of what you've got. It wasn't all about, because you come to rely on a certain sneaking techniques, and he takes those away from you in that boss fight. And you have to basically sneak through a load of different guards and get to him three. I think it's three. Obviously, the rule of three, like three times.
Three or four. I'm not sure. I'm not actually sure. I think it
could be four.
Three.
Actually, they get more difficult and elaborate each time. And it was a challenging boss fight too.
I didn't find it challenging, quite hard. But I thought it was interesting. I thought it was good.
I found it quite hard.
I didn't really find any of the game hard, apart from one or two of the big fights, you know, some of the fights with lots and lots of people there, because on a mouse and keyboard the fighting system isn't as good as it is on a joypad. I've got a joypad as well, and I did flip it, I could dynamically flip between them as I needed to, but I actually got to a point where I was just I'm actually comfortable with the mouse and keyboard. It's not as good, but I don't like the camera control I don't like the automatic camera control when you're fighting with the joypad. With a mouse, I've got total freedom of what I can see and where I can see it, so I can flick around and see someone coming from another direction. Even though I couldn't do, for some reason, due to my configuration, and I hadn't modified anything, so I couldn't use environment takedowns. I had to use the pad for it. So there's two times in the game.
That's
when you fight the pig, Professor Pig, you have to use an environment takedown at the end, and there's another cutscene or quick time event where you have to use an environment takedown. I had to switch to the pad just for that bit, and it was like it was supposedly shift and right click is environment takedown, and it just wouldn't work at all. So
one of the things that I did really like about it was the way they implemented the Joker, because in a weird way, a part of me thinks, oh, it'd be more brave for them to do a Batman where the Joker isn't like the grand focus point of it all, but he's such a fucking good villain.
Yeah.
It kind of feels like this version that they do with the Mark Hamill voice and the way that he's written, he is very evil, but he is funny. Like, the Joker does provide some levity. And what I like about it is the fact that Batman knows the Joker so well. This is a figment of his imagination. Mm. It's the Joker, what should we call it? Is it the infection that he's got, and he gives it to other people as well? Where you have like these other little people that are like the Joker that you have to take down that end up being Jokerized.
Yeah, he gets in. It's during blood transfusions they get some of the Joker's blood or Titan blood or whatever in them, and then they turn into the Joker.
Yeah, and you have to take them down, but at the same time you're also being tormented by your own mind in the form of his worst enemy, which is great. I thought that was really fun and twisted and weird and all the things that the Joker should be, even though he was an imaginary character. And the way that plot ended as well, with locking him away in that sort of like mind prison, I thought that was a really cool thing as well.
That was what I was just going to say. This is another spoiler as well for anyone watching who doesn't want to know. But at the end, where you turn into that, you start controlling the Joker. Where you start controlling the Joker and shooting people, and it's the first time that you kill people, but you think that Batman's kind of turned... This is I suppose it's a metaphor for him turning into the Joker, or is him finally losing it. But it's very much like that whole Scarecrow thing in Arkham... Arkham Asylum, yeah. And it, by the end of it, you overcome it, but it's still very... It still feels very... well done and very, very. It's a bit crazy, but I liked it. I really enjoyed it.
It is. I thought that was a really impressive sequence in general, actually. And I quite like these games for that. The fact that you have this very much, the nuts and bolts mechanics of these games are really solid, but there's always a sequence or a thing where it changes, and you're in a sort of an uneasy place where reality seems to have shifted from what you are accustomed to in the game. Mm. They did that. They've done that in all of them, I think. Arkham City had some of those weird dream sequences where you were flying chasing after Ra's al Ghul, like weird things in Arkham City.
You know, I know there's a lot of mentions of Ra's al Ghul in Arkham Knight, in a lot of the, you know, in the lore, in the reading that you do, but I can't remember Ra's al Ghul in Arkham City. Maybe I didn't.
He is in it, but he's not in it himself that much. He sends out his daughter Talia and her ninja people, who are in it quite a lot, and you do end up having a fight with him and a confrontation with him, but he's not the main guy. It's Hugo Strange is the guy that's constantly there in Arkham City. He's the constant presence.
I can't remember the whole
and the Joker
game, to be fair. I remember the Mr. Freeze fight. I remember Dr. Freeze, sorry, whatever.
Well, that's the interesting thing, because plot-wise, the first and the third... I'm calling this the third one. Arkham City and Arkham Knight have the best stories in their most memorable moments, the best sort of through line. Whereas Arkham City was good, but
Asylum and Arkham Knight.
Arkham Asylum and Arkham Knight, the first and the third are the sort of most solid. I mean, the first one really had the best sort of story, because it was more self-contained. Hmm. You were on the Arkham thingy, it was pretty straightforward. And everything slotted into, because there wasn't a lot of faffing around doing side quests in
wasn't
Arkham.
Much at all. Arkham it was just style. The Joker trophies.
Exactly. So that felt much more direct. Like you were always engaged in that Joker story. The only thing you were doing was like Riddler trophies, if you say. So that had the really cool story. Whereas Arkham Knight had a good story as well. Whereas Arkham City was a little bit like you went to Hugo Strange, to the Joker, to Ra's al Ghul, to this, to the Penguin. And they were all involved in the main plot.
I remember chasing the Deadshot around as well in that one.
Yeah, Deadshot was a side quest though.
Did you fight him, or was it just...
You end up taking him down. He ends up having like a situation where he's on a high point I think it's outdoors, and you have to sneak up to him, but you have to be really sneaky and then basically do a takedown to get him, because he's so accurate. If he sees you, he shoots you dead in one shot, because he's Deadshot. Yeah. So you have to, it's a bit like the Arkham Knight fight. It's a sneaky takedown fight, not a punch and brawl fight.
Right.
So Arkham Knight is very good. And it works on PCs now. So if you have any inclination towards,
it's got still got a few little issues. I mean, I'm not I didn't have a major problem last time. It was only when the Batmobile turned up and there was lots of smoke on the screen that I had slowdown. But I still have to turn off the... there's three settings on the post-processing, and I have to still turn those off for it to be 60 FPS constantly, which I expect from games these days in 1080p. But yeah, it's still definitely playable, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I haven't 100%ed the game for many years either, you know? I do try, and there's always side quests that I go, right, that's, I can't be arsed. I'm not going to get anything for completing that, am I? But I don't know, I really felt compelled to complete everything in this. Plus, I wanted to smash the Riddler's face in by the end of it.
Oh, he is such a wanker. But that's a good thing. You're supposed to want to smash his face in. And all his stupid little blue, green, red robots that he has around. Yeah. That is a bit... The one thing that, if you sort of stop suspending your disbelief, it's like, how the fuck does the Riddler physically actually do all of this stuff? Yeah, like, he's got an army of robots. he's got an army of robots, and he can also build entire, like, racetracks underground.
No, I know the answer to this. It even says it in the actual game. And the Riddler informants say it as well.
Yeah.
No, not the Arkham Knight. The fact that he has henchmen that go around and put and place all the trophies and do all the spray paint and do all of the... I don't know about the racetracks. That isn't explained, but I assume it's them that do that as well.
It's got to be. It's very expensive. And after like three or four times of Batman getting all his riddles, he'd stop doing it. It's like, I will prove myself. You're intellectually superior. It's like, no, you won't.
No, you won't. And even if I left you, so what?
You're just a knob.
That's all he wants to do, though, isn't it? That's the whole premise of him. But he's a comic book character, for fuck's sake. All of them have got one monomaniacal idea about what they need to do in order to piss Batman off in some way, shape, or form.
And most of his main... Well, not even the Joker. Most of the main Batman rogues gallery are all... What's good about them, if you want to get into that, is that they're all some sort of reflection of some part of Batman or Bruce Wayne's own personality. So the Riddler is his need... Because he just have a need. He wants to be the smartest detective in the world, and he has to always defeat the criminals. So the Riddler is a little bit of that. The Joker is just the opposite of his need to have order. The Penguin is like a bad version of what Bruce Wayne would be like if he wasn't a philanthropist. So all of the, like, a lot of the main rogues gallery are all some sort of dark reflection version of Bruce Wayne, which is kind of what makes Batman such an endlessly, like, entertaining character, because of his villains as well that sort of show him his own darkness and all that. So, indeed. Yeah.
Right, enough Batman. Let us move on.
Yeah.
So then, have a go. I'll let you have a go now.
All right. Well, yeah, so Dark Souls 3 came out yesterday, got it delivered, and I played it a little bit yesterday, and I've spent most of today playing it, because it's Dark Souls and it's kind of addictive. And for those who are not familiar with the series, which I think everybody's got a passing familiarity, it's a sort of large dungeon-crawling, combat-based RPG full of dark fantasy... sort of labyrinthian level design and lots of confusing yet very enigmatic and sort of interesting lore that doesn't really make a lot of sense, but it keeps you interested enough in the game that you don't ever just discard it and go, I don't give a shit, who cares who this dragon is or whatever. So it's got a lot of similarities to Bloodborne. It has a lot of the smoothness and sort of slick feeling that Bloodborne had, but it also has the nuts and bolts sort of heavy weighted feeling that Dark Souls is known for. The way that there's a deliberate weapon delay. When you swing a sword, there is a delay between you pressing the button and it hitting the enemy, and you have to take that into account every time you swing your weapon.
Is that on purpose? I mean, you said it's deliberate, but is that not just really annoying?
It's on purpose. It's on purpose, because you've got some weapons that are quite fast. So if you get a rapier, it's quick. It's like it's a stabbing thing, and you can be quite quick with it. But you're trading that for not always a hell of a lot of power. Whereas if you get a greatsword, you swing it, and it's like done, and you've got to really time it right. But when it hits really hard. So the delay on the way weapons move has always been a really strong point since Demon's Souls for me. It makes it feel like they have weight and impact, and the enemies have that too. So you can sometimes get smashed by an enemy, but the enemies always telegraph their attacks in a way that makes you go, well, if I learn the attack patterns, I can overcome this. And it's more about going up to an enemy and almost baiting them to come and attack you and seeing how they move and then moving in when you see an opportunity. Whereas Bloodborne was a little bit of, I'm going to see if I can just stab this guy up quickly before he can hit me. Mm-hmm. So there's a bit slightly different way to approach the combat. And again, anyone who's played Dark Souls will already know this. It's nothing magically different from the other engines in the series. It's just, it's very slick and refined, and it's very, very satisfying to play. Even though you do die quite a lot, it's satisfying when you overcome the bosses and you overcome the enemies. Feels good.
Yeah, I mean,
a bit like Castlevania in the olden days, people say was like that.
I'm trying to find some footage, but unfortunately, everybody is currently online streaming it.
Well, it's a new release, so everyone's like just bumming it, and it's an eagerly awaited release. The franchise has become pretty big franchise, actually. It's a strangely, I guess you could call it a AAA game. It really doesn't fit the AAA mold though, because there's not a lot of hand holding at all. And even where you have to go is kind of like, well, what I like is they use level design to sort of hint where you should go. So if you see like a door with a crack of light coming through it in one area, you'll think, well, that's probably going to lead to something quite important. But I can see there's also a staircase over here that leads down to a dark basement. So you have to then decide, that's going to take me onwards in the game, whereas this is going to take me to something different and interesting, maybe a secret, maybe a hidden thing, a hidden chest, a hidden enemy that I can find. So they don't really hold your hand, and there's no like marker, there's no map in the game. You cannot have a map that tells you where you are. You just have to walk around the environments and get a feel for where they are. Fortunately, because it's so well designed, every area, even though they have a common sort of architecture and things for certain areas, no place is the same. There's no room, no two rooms are the same ever in any of these games, really. They're always like, it feels like a very handmade world. Rather than where something like Oblivion, for example, you might go into, you know, cave number 70, which is just the same as cave number 30, but with different enemies in it. Each environment in this has got its own unique sort of flavor as you traverse it. So you don't need a map necessarily when you just pay attention to your surroundings and just have a general feel of where you are in the world. And it has that really beautiful thing as well. You'll go through a certain area and you'll go down some stairs and go through like a dungeon and a bit of a sewer, and you'll find this ladder that takes you up to a locked door that you couldn't get through before. And you go up it and you're like, oh, I'm back here. And you're back, you've done a loop back on yourself, and you're now back to a place where you were before. Sometimes they have crossroads that have multiple paths that lead back on themselves, so that you can go straight through, but you can also go off and around, but come back in a nice way and find shortcuts.
So the question is, do you get lost?
You do get lost, but you always find your way, though, eventually. Getting lost is kind of part of the game, in a way. You every time you enter a new area, you don't know where you are or what it is that's going to lie in wait for you. So getting lost and then finding your way back is kind of a lot of the appeal of these games for me. It can be confusing. There are some places where you get underground tunnels and stuff, which can be quite confusing, but you always end up finding your way, or you end up getting killed and get put back to the bonfire anyway, so it's fine. Because you're probably going to stumble across some big bad enemy that's going to smash you to death.
Is it as difficult as the other games?
It's actually quite difficult to say, because I've played Demons, Dark Souls, Dark Souls 2, and Bloodborne. I'm going to say no, but I have a lot of experience in this game, so... When I first played Demon's Souls, for example, because I was so unfamiliar with the unique way that the combat works and how the shields and all the stats, there's a lot of stats in this game. If you look at a pause menu for a Dark Souls game, it looks a bit intimidating. You just got all these different icons and numbers, and looking at it without knowing what they are feels a bit intimidating. You're like, all this affects how I swing my sword? What the fuck? But after a while, you sort of get used to what each stat means. You learn to ignore the stats that don't apply to a certain situation.
Yep.
A bit like a lot of RPGs.
Yeah,
but
it's just RPG stuff.
RPG stuff.
You either like stats or you don't. Simple as that.
Yeah, but it's not got... The stats are almost passive. It's like if you have a poison effect on your blade, then yeah, if you hit enemies enough, that poison effect will hit them, and then their life will start to drain away. Simple stuff like that. And you just sort of get to understand it. So it's about sort of creeping around and crawling through these areas and taking each enemy one at a time if you can. And then what's good about it is you can go back to older areas when you've powered up and just steamroller. Not steamroller, because you can still get killed by the first enemies in the game if you're not careful. But you can basically just go through and enemies that felt like impossible before, you just kick their ass. And that makes you feel good. There's a good sense of progression. Well, and this is all stuff that's present in all these games. But this game, it feels they've got a lot of polish now. The visuals are really quite nice. There's a lot of really quite a subtle use of colour. It looks very grey in the footage that you see here, but the game opens up as you go on and you see a lot of different environments and interesting enemy designs, like this weird crystal lizard thing that this guy's been fighting, which is very, very difficult at the start of the game. But now that I'm up to level 15, I've gone back and kicked its head in just because I could. I was like, well, I know that I can do that now, because I've leveled up my swords a bit, leveled up my health, leveled up my strength, all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So anybody, I mean, it's a weird thing. Anybody who's not played Dark Souls, you could easily start at this one because there's a kind of a link between the stories, but they're not really connected that much. You could just start with any of them, really. This one has the nicest graphics and the smoothest gameplay so far. And they've added in some extra combat stuff as well. You've got extra moves you can do with your weapons if you press certain combinations of buttons. So they've made the combat a little bit deeper as well, which is a nice addition. But anybody who's already into the series has already got this game because you knew it was going to be good. Whereas anybody that's a newcomer, this would be an interesting one to start with, actually, because it has nicer combat than in the games. It has more fluid combat than in the games. So
Playing them for a while. I've thought about them since they started, since they started coming out, but it's just never happened. I might get it.
It'd almost be worth you maybe either getting this one on the cheap or getting a cheap copy of the original Dark Souls, having a crack with it and seeing if it gels with you.
I've got the original Dark Souls. Unfortunately, it doesn't work on the PC very well, and I've never been able to get it working.
Oh, really?
I've got a joypad now, though. So. I bet you see that a lot.
Not that you died.
Yeah,
you do, you do. That's just part of the thing, really.
I'll have a look. I'll see if it's available on PC.
Yeah. I mean, I'm absolutely adoring it. I know they kind of... They haven't changed the formula. They just added extra cool stuff to it, which is cool. It's not a revolutionary new entry in the series, but I don't think I really wanted it to be. I just wanted more of that good stuff that they give me. So, yeah, Dark Souls 3. Anybody that's has a passing interest, it's worth a go. Definitely. I love it.
Cool. Okay, so I move on to another game. I've talked about two of the other games that I've been playing this week, last week. Super Mario 3D World, which I was a little bit disappointed with, but I've now completed. I think there's only five worlds in it, and each of them have got maybe eight or nine levels. But some of the levels are, as with all Mario games, insanely difficult. But I've not found this game too hard. The most frustrating thing is, let me put some footage on so you can at least see what I'm talking about. The most frustrating thing with it is that it's not fully 3D, or rather, it's called 3D World. It is 3D. You have a Z axis, but generally the camera's stuck. You can move it left and right, but essentially you're on a 2.5D plane,
Yeah, you can move back and forth, but you're still essentially always going from left to right.
No,
I guess.
No, you can go up and down as well, and there are variations on it.
Okay.
But yeah, this is it's not. I expected it to be Mario 64, which is what I said last week.
Because I think Galaxy is the only games, and Sunshine as well, but that was quite a while ago, where they've really done the 3D behind the third person camera style Mario.
Well, that
Super Mario Galaxy is like that, isn't it?
64 did as well, obviously, but
obviously, but that was the first. But they've gone back to the 2D ones quite a lot, haven't they?
Yeah, I mean, Super Mario Wii U New Super Mario Wii U or whatever it's called was pretty good. Quite enjoyed that. I went back and played Super Mario Wii on the Wii U, which is a Wii game, if you know what I mean. And I got a bit bored of it because it's basically the same game. And I didn't play it originally. I went back to it thinking, oh, I'll give this a go now. But yeah, I got this, and it's a 40 quid game, or it's a 50 quid game rather, but I got it for like 16 quid with a voucher. And I'm glad I didn't pay full price for it, you know. It's not, I don't know, for a main console release, I would have expected it to be a bit more full of things, you know, a bit more content rich, and it just doesn't seem to be that much.
Yeah, I have to say, looking at this footage here, Super Mario Galaxy is quite an impressive game to look at, as in, like, it looks, there's a lot going on. You've got the interesting 3D level design. I know this is only a tiny snippet here, but this looks a little bit stale to me.
This looks a little bit like the first or second level or something. So it's probably not a lot going on. There are some really interesting levels, don't get me wrong, and there's some really interesting concepts as well. Like, you can blow on the Wii U gamepad to blow enemies off the screen and make things move around and that kind of thing. You can swipe on the Wii U gamepad to do certain things in levels as well. It's not as good as I was expecting it to be. I thought it was going to be a full 3D world with a, you know, completely controllable camera, and it just isn't as good.
You basically wanted Mario 64 2 whatever that logical thing.
That's totally what I was expecting, but I didn't even look it up, so, you know, I just got it thinking, oh, it's going to be good. And it's not bad. I'm probably going to keep playing it, and I've completed it. The final boss battle's pretty cool. I mean, the Bowser battles are always pretty interesting these days, but I didn't really... There was nothing that was really, really challenging. Either that, or I've played, you know, I mean, Galaxies and Galaxy 2 was insanely difficult in places. There's nothing that's really, really challenging. Once I got used to the control system and got used to the how to move on the Z-axis, because it's one of those games where you'll run around and you won't know quite where you're going to land, you know, because of the way the camera's set. So quite a lot of times I'd die, or I'd jump in lava, or I'd misjudge hitting an enemy because I couldn't quite figure out where I was going to be, until you start looking at where your shadow is, and then you realise where you're going to land, and it's you end up not looking at Mario at all and just staring at his shadow for the entire game,
and that's kind of an issue.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, it's all right, and I've completed it now, so that's, I just wanted to mention that I had completed it. The other game that I'd already played quite a lot of and haven't, I think, actually, you know what, I completed it today. I completed it while I was recording this. Is a game called Knights of Pen and Paper Plus One.
Yeah, I'm intrigued to see what that's about.
So let's just do a share. So you'll hate this. Nobody last week even responded to it, but it's Dungeons and Dragons. That's what it is, and it's you are real people in the pen and paper world, sat in front of a table.
All right.
And you have a games master, and he tells you a story, and you move from place to place. You're basically playing Dungeons and Dragons in a game, and you can choose how many enemies you do, and you have to roll dice in order to kill people and stuff. And it's actually a lot of fun, and I've really enjoyed playing it. I've completed the main content, but there's also some additional content that is already included in it, and I might keep going back to it. I don't know. I've played it quite a lot now. I think I'm on about 20 hours or something, but it's quite addictive.
So it functions the same way as a normal Dungeons and Dragons game, where you have the Dungeon Master will give you like a quest, and then you...
It's linear. The quest is linear. However, you can choose... like what I'm doing right now is I'm choosing the amount of enemies that I want to fight in a particular area, and then you have different skills for all of your characters, and you can choose up to 5 characters at the table at any point, but you can have additional characters. So I've at the moment I've got a rogue, a druid, a paladin, a cleric, and a wizard, And you can. There's also a few more of. I haven't used. Oh, there's a warrior as well, which I thought was the tank, but it's actually the paladin that's a proper tank in this. And you upgrade your skills as you go along, and it's up to you how you upgrade your characters. But there is, I think, to be fair, a preferred way to do it. You know, it does very much feel like I've played it four times initially, and I just completely screwed my character setups. I didn't really know what the characters were for, but now I've got used to it. I hardly ever die, hardly lose any characters. So at the moment, my paladin's using Leader Strike, which is it increases his threat, so all of the enemies attack him. That's a general tank technique with any kind of RPG. And he's also using a shield as well, so that reduces his damage by 50%. The cleric's job is to kind of put some buffs on the enemies, such as weakening them, and also heal everybody. Your rogue's job is generally to deal as much physical damage as possible, and the mage's job is as much magical damage as possible, and the druid is kind of a support character normally. But that's just generally what RPGs are about. That's, you know, if you play World of Warcraft, you always fill one of those roles or a variation of that kind of role, and it's the same thing. But here is, you see, I'm in front of a pool table.
Yeah, I did notice that.
You can upgrade your table and your furniture in your room, and like the pool table gives you, I think, something like plus one mana regeneration per turn or whatever. All them little numbers that are popping up on my characters are all the stats, you know, all the health and mana regenerating each turn. Some of the battles take forever. I mean, I think if I just scroll it on a little bit, this is the final boss, I believe. Not spoiling anything, because I think there's very few people who are going to play this game. It's a good game, don't get me wrong, but I just don't think it's... you know, with it being an indie game as well, it doesn't get as much attention as it maybe should do, you know.
It has niche appeal, I think, this kind of game. It isn't the kind of game that I would probably enjoy playing that much, but I can understand the appeal of it.
Yeah,
should, I mean, do you see what I mean?
I started playing it on the train, because I was travelling to and from one of my client sites quite a lot over the last few months, and just started playing it and got a little bit addicted to it, because that's what I was doing for 2 hours, 4 hours a day or whatever. Well, for the time I wasn't doing work anyway. But yeah, it's all right. It's good. You know, it's got some like light humour in it as well. A lot of the dialogue's written in kind of tongue-in-cheek way, kind of taking the piss out of itself, taking the piss out of Dungeons & Dragons, and also going... It's a lot of fourth wall stuff as well. It's interesting, you know. I think that's actually.
I was going to ask about that. Is there anything of the excellent Dungeons and Dragons episode of Community about it, where there's like an interplay between the characters at all, or do the people at the pool table, are they relevant in any way, or are they just the party?
They're the party. Like they do talk. It seems to be. Doesn't matter which position people are in, because you can move the positions and you can leave certain characters at the tavern and get other characters, but I've only ever just worked with this set because it works. But they do have dialogue. They talk to the dungeon master as the dungeon master's doing things, and they also talk to the NPCs in the world as well. So say, for example, you're doing a quest for somebody. In fact, if I move this on, you'll see some dialogue here, I think. It's nearly dead. Here we go. So this is the final boss telling me off, and I've finished the game, so it's taken me back into the living room, and then something else happens, and he ends up coming into the real realm, like the real world, and it's quite comedy at the moment. Again, spoilers, right, for anybody who does care. He comes into the real world, and he kicks off into a battle with you again, and you hit him once and he's dead, and he's like, oh, I'm dead weak in the real world. Then that's it, end of the game. It's just okay. Funny. So it's one of those, you play it, it's not a massive arcing story, but it's, you know, it's fun enough. And considering, again, I got it in a bundle, I think, I can't complain. I've got plenty of hours from it. Here we go. I think I cast a fireball on him and he's dead. There you go.
Is that like glow in the dark door from Moria in the background from the Lord of the Rings as well?
Yes, it is. But you can customize your door, the mat, the walls, the floor, all of the furniture in the room, and they all give you different stats. There's also like the first ring that you get, or the first good ring that you get, like she's 15 magic or something. It's called the One Ring, you know, Lord of the Rings. And then as you get further into the game, you get the Two Ring, the Three Ring, the Four Ring, you know. Anyway, it's daft. It's a good bit of fun, but I've now completed it. And I'd recommend it to anybody who that kind of a thing appeals to, you know. Mm-hmm. So, any other games you played, Sam?
As I was in between waiting for Dark Souls 3 to come out and finishing The Witcher, I played Resident Evil 4 through again. I've had a little bit of a dabble in Resident Evil again, as I often do periodically, because they're usually quite short games, and I enjoy them. So I just was like, oh, I'll have a bit of go Resident, because I played a bit of the old school stuff. I played Resident Evil 3 again recently, went through the remake again recently, and I was like, oh, I'll go for the one where it changed and became more action-y. And it is a very marked difference when you play through the other ones and go to Resident Evil 4. It's so different in tone. It's not like the original Resident Evils took themselves that seriously, because they were always pretty goofy.
Hmm.
But it did get into the sort of, like, really ridiculous stuff. Like, this is in a castle, by the way, that has a room full of lava in it, because they wanted to have a room full of lava in this bit. I know that you've had a go with it, and you didn't really get along with it, because, strangely enough, this is something that I didn't really notice until it was pointed out to me. This game still has tank controls. It's just that now the camera's stuck behind you, which I never really clocked until it was pointed out to me, which is maybe why I get along with the control system so well, because I'm so familiar with old-school Resident Evil controls.
Yeah.
This game still manages to be quite scary, though. It has quite a lot of horror moments, whereas Resident Evil 5 was all, like, sun-bleached Africa. It had a lot of monsters in it, but it wasn't scary. This game still has some sort of really creepy and scary moments in it, which means it can still be classified as a horror game for me, even though it's very, very action-oriented, especially towards the end as well.
Yeah, I've got it, and it's one of those things. The wife's asked me to play, because she likes Resident Evil games, and I said we play quite often together. Mm. I should say I play a game, and she enjoys watching them. But I don't know. I just find them boring. I find it really arbitrary. I find it really slow, if you know what I mean, to make any progress. And I find the backtracking really frustrating as well. What's going on here? Why is it suddenly sped up?
Oh, I think the person doing the gameplay has obviously sped it up, haven't they?
Oh, right. I thought it might have been something in the game then. I was like, what the hell?
No, it's not. It's obviously a Let's Player who's saying, oh, let me just rush through this bit.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the things I liked about this game was the fact that, I mean, some people hate this sort of stuff, but it added in a lot of context-sensitive actions. So there's one action button, but if you attack your enemies in a certain way, you can dodge them or kick them. So let's say you shoot an enemy in the head, they'll sort of go, and you run up to them, and a kick icon will appear. Then you can kick them over, and then that will do splash damage to other enemies that are around them. So there's quite a lot more stuff to do with the combat, and it is worth noting as well, games like Gears of War and things like that would not be the way they are without Resident Evil 4 to set them up.
I'm absolutely, definitely not saying they're awful games. I just find them a little bit boring, a little bit.
Yeah.
I don't know. I enjoyed 1 and 2 when I first played them. And I say this every time we talk about Resident Evil. I just don't want to play anymore. You know?
Yeah.
I've had enough.
That's fair enough.
Those kind of games. It's like, I don't know. But then again, I talk about Mario, you know. I still play Mario. It's the same game, basically, with new graphics. But I enjoy that. I don't know.
It's just subjective, isn't it? I do like Resident Evil 4 just because, again, it did. I know that third-person sort of over-the-shoulder shooters have moved on since Resident Evil 4, but Resident Evil 4 did set the tone and a benchmark for a lot of what those kind of games became. So games like Gears of War and Uncharted owe a lot of their design philosophy to Resident Evil 4 because of the way that it did this kind of combat and this kind of, I don't really know, this sort of gameplay, really.
Yeah.
It takes a lot from Resident Evil 4, even though Resident Evil itself has never... Here's the interesting thing about Resident Evil 4. They did this game, in my opinion, so well that they could never be as good. They could never do this game over this over-the-shoulder view as well as they did it here, because they threw so much into this game. This game's like so mad. I mean, look at that shit. The game starts out in a creepy like village with villagers coming at you with pitchforks, and it feels really weird and like creepy and impressive, but it gets mad towards the end. So they did so much in this game that they can never match it in the subsequent ones that kept to this style, which is why, you know, they did the remastered remake and it sold like gangbusters, because people were not into Resident Evil 6. Everyone wanted to go back to that like old school, scary, conserve your ammo kind of Resident Evil that they started off with. Yeah. So it's a weird, it's kind of like, it's the turning point, but it's like a really high point in the series. But then the series really went, it went like that and then went boom down and can never come back once it, Resident Evil kind of was great, but also killed the franchise in a way. So it's kind of a strange bit of gaming history in that regard too. But yeah. I always enjoy playing it. It's a very fun game. The combat is, again, the way that when the enemy explodes and you can fucking kick their head in and then all that kind of stuff. I just find it really, really enjoyable to play. So. Yeah, I've played that again a few times in my life before I die, Resident Evil 4.
Well, I said I'd say the same about Final Fantasy 7, and you couldn't, you know, you can't get on with that, can you?
I enjoyed it a little bit. I think I probably could play it through to completion, but I didn't find the gameplay enjoyable that much. I enjoyed the story, the atmosphere.
Yeah. Okay, so, lastly, I've been playing a game over the last 2 or 3 days, so I've only played maybe 4 or 5 hours of this, but it's a game that I've had my eye on for ages, and I've had it in my Steam library for ages. I think I actually bought this game. I didn't get it in a bundle for once. And it's called Satellite Rain. And it's kind of a cyberpunk stealth slash RPG slash kind of isometric, kind of pseudo-isometric game, and I think it was touted as the spiritual successor to Syndicate, which is a very old PC game. I don't know if it was on any more than just the PC.
I'm sure it was on the PlayStation as well, the original PlayStation.
Possible. But Syndicate was, I mean, renowned at the time for how much you could do in it, and you know how cool the mechanics were, but. This is supposedly, I mean, the thing is here is I haven't played Syndicate that much. I played Syndicate Wars a little bit. I played Syndicate a little bit, but I wasn't really into it when I was a kid, when I was younger. But this looks very nice. It's a very pretty looking game. It does take a lot out of your graphics card, I'll tell you that much. It's either that or it's badly optimized. And essentially you control, I think it seems to be up to 4 agents. And each of those agents has a specific skill. So you've got a soldier, you've got a hacker, you've got an infiltrator, and you've got a support unit. The hacker obviously does hacking. The soldier is better at fighting. Support unit's better at, I don't know, supporting people, giving them a hug, maybe. I don't know.
I'm figuring it out yet.
And the infiltrator is obviously better at infiltrating bases and things like that. But so far, it seems to be, I'm only in the first area, and I'm assuming there's more than one area. It seems to be very mission-based. So from what I can tell is you are a company that is trying to take down another big megacorp. And you have to infiltrate certain areas of the city, disabling cameras, open, you know, hacking doors open, collecting items. You can shoot people, you can go all guns blazing if you want, but it's quite difficult because they'll call in support. But stealth seems to be the best option. Excuse me. So far I'm really enjoying it. It's taken me a little bit. I think the first 2 or 3 hours the tutorials are very minimal. It doesn't hold your hand at all, and it's quite, there's quite a lot of reading involved, you know, there's quite a lot of, not just a tutorial, which is that box that you see flashing on the right-hand side, but there's also a lot of, like, mission, the mission control tab right at the top left, that's where all your missions are, and as you hack more terminals, and as you do more things within the game world, you just open up tons and tons of missions, and all of these missions are to either cut down the amount of time a camera can take to, or increase the amount of time a camera takes to detect you, to reduce the visibility of troops, to enable So you can rob banks and get like big caches of money. You can stick siphons on ATM machines in order to get more money as well. So at the moment, I think the mission I'm doing is I'm going off to get my infiltrator because he's been captured. So I've only got three agents right now. But when I get to the infiltrator, so I think I'm sending my hacker off to disable the cameras so the rest of my guys can come out and go off and either fight some people or go and get the infiltrator from the unit. It sounds more complicated than it actually is. So far, it doesn't seem that complex. It seems like there's more... It looks and comes across more complicated than the actual mechanics of the game are.
It doesn't look that complicated. It looks like it wouldn't be that difficult to get to grips with.
You haven't seen the menus yet. Yeah, I think at the beginning it's just a bit weird. You've got one agent, you've got the soldier guy, and it's taking you through how to do some things. And it's like, well, why have I just done that? There's one moment where I had to clone myself. I had to clone... When you die, you have, because it's cyberpunk, you know, you get the ability to clone somebody else's body as yourself, your own consciousness. So you've got infinite lives, apparently, from what I can tell so far. But it's very easy to die if you get caught out, if you're not stealthy enough. Mm-hmm. But I think all your agents are going to have to work together, and it's going to be more and more complicated. At the moment, all my agents are together, but I think at some point it's going to make more sense to start splitting them up and leave a hacker in one place so he can hack some consoles, send the soldier off to distract some guards, and then send off your support unit or your infiltrator unit to go, you know, slip in unnoticed while your soldier's drawing fire or something like that. There's going to be a few more complicated missions than that. And so far, I'm really enjoying it. And I know Steve's played it a little bit as well, but he's only played it a little bit, like a really small amount.
Is it a recent release? Is it just out?
It's been out for a while now, probably about 6 months, maybe a bit longer than that. And I think it's an indie game. I think it is.
It looks very slick, though.
Yeah, well, to be fair, there's a lot of indie games these days that are starting to look slick. And a good way of doing it is post-processing effects. And, you know, if you zoom in, you can actually zoom in and out as well, but it's better to have a more, you know, overview of the world in this kind of game. But I managed to do that successfully without actually getting seen. But it's quite difficult in some places because, again, getting used to the systems and recognizing there's a camera there and recognizing that you're in a restricted area. And sometimes you can have been in a firefight, escape, like you've killed someone, escape, and then you walk in front of a camera that's not in a restricted zone, and you haven't put your gun away, you've forgotten to, so you get seen immediately, and then loads of bots and drones get called on you. But there's a lot of text, as I said. There's a lot of mission. But I am quite enjoying it so far. I don't think there are many games I'm not enjoying, to be fair, at the moment. I think I'm choosing them quite well as things stand. That mission there, I just actually when I went into the building, that's essentially the end of the mission or the target of the mission. I came out and I actually had another guy, so I've now got four agents across the bottom. But there's a lot of things going on, and there's the scanning you can do of areas, and I said there's quite a lot of skills you can upgrade, and there's research, and this clone thing I don't understand yet. I don't understand what I've managed to clone the same body with two consciousnesses at the moment, so it's weird. Or I've got the same face, but I don't get it. I don't really know what's going on with the cloning side of things. But yeah, I'm going to keep playing it, though. I'm enjoying it. I think it's going to be my game of the moment, so I might have more to say next week or whenever we next do the show. And that is it for my games, I think.
That's it for my games, too.
Yeah. Well, there was one news story we were going to talk about, and I'm not sure if... There's much to say, really, but there's been some Deus Ex Mankind Divided gameplay released, but it's not gameplay trailers or footage. It's actually just footage of an office, of the Eidos Montreal office, and pictures of people's screens with a bit of gameplay footage on it. You know, it's not that great, but it just looks like the last game so far, Human Revolution, and I really
enjoyed
that. It's
not a bad
that.
Thing.
No, and I'm really looking forward to it though.
I am as well. When is it out? Is it?
Don't know.
It's towards the end of this year, isn't it? I think I've got like a lot of the games seem to come out before the summer and after the summer. So I think it's probably in that October, November time, possibly. Could be totally wrong about that. Could be like July.
August 23rd, 2016.
There you go.
And you know what? I'm happy to wait for it. I would absolutely love a Deus Ex open world game, and I don't know if this is going to be open world or not.
Yeah, well, the other one had very open areas. Like there was it's Detroit it's in, isn't it? Detroit. When you go to that, when you get out of the building at the start of the game, and you have like that open area bit, and there's a couple of missions you can do there. So there's like a hub area, like again, those areas that were open, and you can go and do missions in there. But it wasn't open world. But it wasn't like linear, go down a corridor to the next part of the level. There were open sections of the game.
Yeah,
You could go and explore the apartment buildings, couldn't you? And you could go and like explore that factory and go and do stuff.
It's hub based gameplay, and it's.
That though.
Freestyle hub-based gameplay. You can do what you want within the hubs, but Deus Ex Human Revolution was a little bit bigger. But the bigger they get, the better. In my eyes, I would quite happily live with a. I think it's going to be difficult for them to do because there's so much content and it's so detailed. The world that they put together.
Exactly.
But I would love a, you know, Arkham City or GTA size Deus Ex world that you can just go. That's what I wanted to create with my game. I wanted to create a world where you could go into every building and you could hack everything and you can get to the servers and do jobs and stuff. That'd be awesome. But it's
the thing is though, if you think about a city, so let's say you have one 30-floor skyscraper.
Means
there has to be however many rooms there are on each floor times 30 times all the buildings in the city. It is a gargantuan like undertaking to actually do that.
It took me about a year on my own. This is learning as well to make a five-story single building that was all laid out with puzzles with. You know, all of the doors and all of the kind of network devices and stuff set up inside it, and it still doesn't feel. It takes you 5 seconds to walk around it. You know, it's like it's a very difficult undertaking, even with people who are professionals and have got a lot of resources and time to do this kind of thing. But I'm really looking forward to it. And I know Lou kind of went off Deus Ex after Human Revolution, but Lou doesn't like games anymore, so I don't pay attention to him.
His opinion is null.
His opinion is null. So, yes, unless there's any other news, I think we'll have an early night tonight.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Yeah, I think I'll go off and watch some things with my wife and maybe eat some
play cake. Dark Souls 3.
I'm considering playing Satellite Rain for a little bit, but probably better I shouldn't. I've got tomorrow night to do that anyway. So yes, thank you very much for those who are watching, and this will be up on YouTube as per usual, and we'll catch you next time. Thank you very much. See you later, guys. Bye-bye.